Okay, so as we talked about in the last video, logic is the study of arguments. And an argument is a set of sentences that's intended to provide reasons for accepting some statement as true. So the point of an argument is always to prove that something is true. All right, so how do you go about doing that? How do you convince someone of something that they don't already believe? You know, in life, there's a lot of options. You can threaten someone, bribe them, intimidate them, trick them, do something like that. But even though you might win arguments that way, it isn't really convincing the other person, right? Not in a rational way, at least. So in logic, the way you get someone to accept something that they don't already believe is to start with some statements that they do believe, and then show them that if they accept those statements, then they have to accept what you are claiming as well. In what sense do they have to accept it? Well, let's look at an example to try to illustrate this point. So here's a set of sentences, and suppose you met someone who believes A and B, so they believe that either Alice is at work or she's at home, and they believe that Alice is not at home, but they don't believe Z, they don't believe that Alice is at work. How would you react to this kind of person? Well, I might think that they were kind of weird or irrational or something like that, right? How could you possibly believe that Alice is at home or at work and not at home, but not at work either? It's totally incoherent. So there's clearly something irrational about believing A and B to be true, but not believing Z to be true. And that's the sense in which you have to believe Z if you believe A and B. You have to believe it if you want to be a sane or rational person. And for the purposes of this class, we'll just assume everyone is rational. Okay, let's look at another example. Again, suppose you met someone who believes A and B. They believe that Alice is taller than Bob, and they believe that Bob is taller than Carol, but they don't accept Z, that Alice is taller than Carol. All right, clearly this person is confused. If person X is taller than person Y, and person Y is taller than person Z, then necessarily person X is taller than person Z. Right, in mathematical terms, we might say that being taller than is a transitive property. But in any case, it would simply be crazy to accept A and B and deny Z. Right? So in these cases, we'll say that A and B entail Z. And these simple examples illustrate a very interesting point that certain sentences can be related to each other in such a way that if you accept some of the sentences as true, then you have to accept others as true as well if you want to be rational. And this relationship between sentences is known as entailment, and it's one of the central topics that we'll be exploring in this class. So in this example, we would say that A and B together entail Z. And with this idea, this means that one way that you can get someone to accept some statement that they don't already agree with is to start with some claims that they will accept and then show that those statements entail what you are trying to establish. In other words, show them that if they accept those sentences, they have to accept your statement as well. So that's one kind of intuitive way about thinking about the overall structure or strategy of a logical argument and how we go about proving things in logic. So we can now identify the basic components of a logical argument. Okay, so the goal of an argument is always to establish some statement or claim as true. And this is known as the conclusion of the argument. It's the target or the goal, the thing you're trying to prove. So every argument has to have a conclusion and might have more than one. And as we just saw, the way we're going to prove the conclusion is by starting with some statements that hopefully your opponent will already accept and which are meant to provide the reasons or the basis for accepting the conclusion. So every argument has to start somewhere. So every argument has to offer some information that's supposed to justify the conclusion. You can't just state the conclusion, right? Just asserting the conclusion wouldn't count as giving an argument. So every argument also needs to have one or more premises. And these provide the raw materials necessary for the argument. Okay, so we have the premises and the conclusion. And once you have the premises, you use deductive reasoning to show that if the premises are true, the conclusion has to be true, just as in the previous example. So in other words, you perform inferences on the basis of the premises in order to reach the conclusion. So these are the basic components that we'll find in every argument. The basic structure consists of one or more premises, some inferential steps on the basis of those premises, and one or more conclusions, although usually just one. In English, the order of these parts is not set in stone. So in some cases, you might see that the conclusion is actually the first sentence in the paragraph or whatever, and then the premises or the reasons are given after. However, once we convert the argument to symbolic notation, we'll always list the premises first, then the inferential steps, and finally the conclusion. So put it in a more standard format. And that's another reason why we use symbolic notation when we're doing logic. Finally, when you have longer arguments, you might find that if you're trying to prove some statement, let's call it Z, it might be helpful first to prove some other statement, like X or Y. So you have some premises to start with, and then you use those premises to prove X, let's say, and then you use X to prove Y, and then finally you use Y to prove Z. So in these cases, X and Y are not exactly premises because they themselves are the result of inferential steps. But they're not exactly the conclusion either because they're just stepping stones on the way to Z, which is what we're really trying to prove. So they're kind of in between, and we'll call them intermediate conclusions. So an intermediate conclusion is a statement that is the result of inference from the premises, but it's not the main conclusion or goal of the argument. Right? A premise is something which, within the structure of a particular argument, premises are not themselves argued for or justified. They're just stated. So the way you can tell an intermediate conclusion, or a conclusion in general, from a premise is that intermediate conclusions are the result of inferential steps. So they don't add any new information or independent information to the argument. They're just supposed to bring out information that's contained in the premises and connect the information in the premises. So premises are supposed to add independent information to the argument, and conclusions are derived by inferring things on the basis of the premises. Okay, so let's look at some more examples to illustrate these concepts. So here's a very simple argument, slightly longer than the others, but still pretty simple. If Dave takes the bus to work, he will be late. If Dave is late, he will be fired. So if Dave takes the bus to work, he will be fired. Dave is taking the bus to work, therefore, Dave will be fired. Okay, so let's break this argument down using the concepts that we just introduced. A and B in this case are straightforward premises. They're information that is stated in order to kind of get the argument going, let's say. Right? If Dave takes the bus to work, he'll be late. If Dave is late, he'll be fired. Those are two independent pieces of information. Now if we look at C, C is kind of combining the information that you find in A and B. Right, so in that sense, C is not an independent premise. Okay, if Dave takes the bus to work, he'll be late. If Dave's late, he'll be fired. So connecting those two things, if Dave takes the bus to work, he'll be fired. So C is drawing out the sort of logical connections between A and B, and in that sense, it's not a premise. But it's also not the main thing that we're trying to prove in this argument, which is that Dave is going to be fired. So it's a perfect example of what we call an intermediate conclusion. Okay, now we get to D, and the person presenting this argument offers another premise. Right? D, if we look at it, Dave is taking the bus to work. This is an independent piece of information which can't be inferred from any of the previous statements. So it's simply a premise, even though it comes a little bit later in the argument. And then finally, the conclusion, therefore Dave will be fired. This is really connecting the information in C and D. If Dave takes the bus to work, he'll be fired. Dave is taking the bus to work, so he'll be fired. So it's a result of inferential steps on C and D, and it's also the main point of the argument. So this is actually the conclusion of the argument. All right, so you see these basic pieces, although we're looking at very simple arguments here, these same parts and components are used to make arguments of any kind of complexity. Let's look at another example just to get some more practice with these concepts. So take a look at these sentences. Maybe pause the video and try to decide for yourself which of them are premises, which is the conclusion, and if any, are there any intermediate intermediate conclusions? Okay. Okay, so again, this argument is kind of mixing up the order of these things, we might say, insofar as it starts with the conclusion by saying, I can't come to your party on Friday. So even though this is the first statement, if you understand the rest of the argument, you can see that the rest of it is basically providing reasons and justification for the conclusion. So although this is slightly different than the way we've looked at the other arguments, it's also a very common structure or pattern that you'll find in arguments. So we start by stating the conclusion, and then we offer two pieces of information. I can either go to your party or study for my final exam. Again, that can't be inferred from any other statements in the argument. It's just an independent piece of information. And the same thing with C. If I don't study for my final exam, I'll fail the class. Then we have another piece of information. I can't fail the class. And then finally, E puts together the information in C and D and combines that with B to reach the conclusion that I have to study for my final exam, which implies that I can't come to the party. So E, you know, there's a very short step from E to A, which is actually the main conclusion of the argument, even though it's stated first. So E is not the final goal of the argument, but it is also a conclusion insofar as it is derived on the basis of the information contained in the other premises. So again, it's a good example of an intermediate conclusion. All right, so some of the key concepts that we introduced in this video are entailment, that special relationship that holds between sentences, wherein if you accept some of the statements as true, you have to accept the other statement if you're going to be rational. And then we talked about some of the parts of an argument, such as the premise, the conclusion, and intermediate conclusion.